Hay Akdomus milen vishara is shusa avlo shokilno almanur shusa bivavei treyus las di eftach minak shusa bivavei dvorei vitorei adeli kash shusa. The Akdomus Milin Kindalach. You all know that on the Yom Tif of Shavuos, it is a minig that Yidden stay up the entire night learning Torah in Shul. And in the morning with the Netz Hachama, when the sun comes up, they daven. And when they get up to laning Kindalach, before they start laning the Torah, the Baal Koireh sings a beautiful song together with the people. And that song is the song of Akdomus Milin. And in the Akdomus, it says the greatness of the Rebbeinu Shel Olam and his love, his deep love that he has for Klal Yisrael. Who wrote this beautiful song called Akdomus? Who made it up? Listen very closely, my entire Kindlech. And you will hear this unbelievable story that took place about 1,000 years ago in a faraway land, far away from all the land. There was a little town, and that town had Yidden, and it had Goyim. And in that town, Kindalach, there were a lot of Talmidei Chachomim. But also in that town, Kindalach, there was a Galach. And this Galach was a kishifmacher. He was able to use the koyach hatumeh and to do kishif with the koyach hatumeh to hurt people. And that's what he would do. He lived up on a little hill. And on the little hill was his cloister. And in the basement of his cloister, Kindalach, he had all his magic and all his kishiv, and from there he would make all kinds of tzoris for the Yidden. The Yidden would come to shul to tell the Talmidei Chachamim what happened. And here comes one person, Levi Lav Tzoris. He comes into the shul and he walks over to Talmidei Chachamim. We're in the middle of learning, and they turn around. They say, "Yes, Levi Lav Tzoris, what can we do for you?" "Ay vey. Ay vey, Rabbeisai, it's gefährlich. You're not going to believe it. My neighbor Chaim. Ay vey. He's not feeling well. I had to take him in the middle of the night to the hospital. Ay gewalt. He has a headache. He has a throatache. He has an earache. Ay vey. He has a backache. He has a legache. He has an acheache. Ay gewalt. And I took him to the hospital. And I took his wife along. Ay gewalt. And there was blood. Ay vey. And his wife was crying. Bechiyas. Yalalas. Ay vey. And when I took her home from the hospital, she was so upset. And I took her home, and she was so upset. In my car, I took her. Oy vey, don't ask. Oy gewalt, they thought. Noch amol, it's this Galach that's making the tzoras for the Yidden. Okay, Reb Levi, we're going to see what we have to do about this. Oh, Reb Levi leaves. And again, the Talmidei Chacham go back to the Gemoras, and they're in the middle of the Rischdoi Reise. They're learning Gishmak by the Gemoras. And all of a sudden, into the Beis Medrash comes another Yid. Oh, what can we do for you, Reb Oizer?
Ay, gewalt, you're not going to believe what happened to me. My whole store is burnt down to the ground. I had a hat store. Ay, gewalt, I sold hats with big brims. I sold hats with small brims. I sold kutchmes. I sold Russian hats. I sold caps. The entire store is burnt to the ground. Ay, my whole parnasse. It's up in smoke. What am I going to do, gewalt geschrieben? Oh, I think it's the Galach with his koyach hatumeh. Oh, Tat in Himmel, oh, Father in Heaven, what am I going to do?
Oi, calm down, Reb Daniel. Hopefully we'll be able to do something about this Galach we're going to talk about and figure out what to do. And before they're finished speaking, in comes Reb Israel. Oi, Reb Israel, what can we do for you?
This morning, I got up and I washed Nagelwasser and I put on my pants. Then I put on my shirt. I said good morning to my wife. No, no, no. So what? Wait. This morning, I got up, I put on my pants, and then I put on my shirt. I put on my socks and then my shoes. I said good morning to my wife. I went into the kitchen and made a coffee. Then I got ready to go to work. So what happened? What happened? Wait. This morning, I woke up. I put on my pants. Then I put on my shirt. I put on my socks. I put on my shoes. I said good morning to my wife. I went into the kitchen. I made a coffee. I started going to work. I opened the front door. I went to the barn. So what happened, Reb Israel? Wait. This morning, I got up. I washed Nagelwasser. Apparently, Rabbeisai, the Galach must have done something to Reb Israel as well. We have to do something about this Galach. This is a big problem. This is not the first time that Eden came complaining about him. And so Kindalach, the Talmidei Chachomim, got together and they sat around a big table and they started to discuss what to do about this Rosha, this Kishef Macher, who's making such tzoris for the Eden.
Rabbeisai, this is a big problem. We have to do something about this Galach. We can't allow him to do such things to the Yidden here. He's making such tzoris to the entire Yidden of this community. We have to come up with some sort of eitzah how to deal with him.
One of the Rabbonim said,
but who can say that they can stop a Galach like this? He is very strong in the Koyach HaTumeh. Who can shtel zachakegen? Who can stand up to such a Russia that is so strong in the Koyach HaTumeh?
And now Kindalech, the most choshev Talmud Chochem in the city, the wisest of all the Talmidei Chachomim, began to speak.
Rabbeisai, we definitely have a big problem here. I suggest...
And everybody listened up very closely when this great tzaddik spoke. He was very, very big Talmud Chochem and a very wise person.
That we bald, since our community and all the Yidden in the entire country are very beloved by our king, that we should send a shliach, the Rosh HaKol, the president of our community, Reb Yosef Meir, to speak on behalf of the entire community to the king.
Gerecht! We'll send a messenger right now to go get a hold of the president, the Rosh HaKol.
So they sent out a messenger to go get the Rosh HaKol, Rabbi Yosef Meir. Rabbi Yosef Meir was a very big Askeni, helped out anybody that needed help. He was very respected by the king. And he came walking in very fast.
Bibi, what seems to be the problem?
Rabbi Yosef Meir, we have a big problem over here. This Galach, this Kishef Macher, is making terrible tzoris for the Yidden. This morning alone, we had 3 complaints. We need someone to go speak to the king on behalf of the Yidden in this town. And we know that you're very close to the king. Please, can you go on our behalf and speak to the king that he should do something about this Rosha?
Vivi, you want me to speak to the king that he should do something about this Rusha? Let me just make sure that I understand what you're saying. Is that what you're saying, Vivi?
That's exactly what we are all suggesting.
It'll be my greatest kuvid, my greatest honor to represent the entire community and speak to the king on behalf of the entire community. It'll be my greatest honor, my greatest pleasure, Vivi.
And so, Kindalach, Rabbi Yosef Meir got onto his beautiful horse and he started heading towards the king's castle. Now, Kindalach, in those days, about 1,000 years ago in the Middle Ages, the kings lived in castles, and the castles were surrounded by what they called a moat. A moat was a very deep hole, and that hole was full of water. So if enemy soldiers came to attack the castle, they couldn't get through because there was a deep hole full of water. So they could not get through to the castle. Now, to get past the moat, you had to go over the bridge. And the bridge was called a drawbridge because it was a big, giant piece of wood that they can pull up that served as a door for the castle wall. So Reb Yosef Meir comes riding up to the castle, and when the servants sees him riding up to the castle, right away they lower the giant drawbridge, and Reb Yosef Meir comes riding in over the drawbridge, and a squire, which is a type of servant in those days, takes Reb Yosef Meir's horse and puts it where the king keeps his horses, and then another meshoris, another servant, takes Reb Yosef Meir to the waiting room outside the king's throne room. And the servant goes in and speaks to the king and then comes out and says, Reb Yosef Meir, you may come in. The king would love to see you. And in comes Reb Yosef Meir.
Welcome, welcome. Welcome, the president of the town. I'm so happy and so honored that the Yidden sent me their president once again. You know how beloved the Jewish people of my country are to me. What can I do for you?
Vivi?
What can I do for you?
Your Majesty, I very much appreciated that you are so loyal to the Jewish community. I wanted to talk to you about a very serious matter. In our town, I'm sure you know that there is a Galach, a Kishevmacher. This particular Kishevmacher is making terrible tzuris for the Yidden. He's doing all kinds of problems for us. So if you can intercede, maybe if you can talk to him to stop doing these problems for the Yidden, then we would very much appreciate it, Your Majesty.
Oh, of course. It would be my greatest pleasure to speak to you. I am just forewarning you. He is a very powerful man. And to a certain degree, I am afraid of him.
Vivi?
I am afraid of him myself, but I will talk to him nonetheless.
Thank you very much. You are greatly appreciated by the entire Jewish community. I will go back and tell the Talmidei Chachamim what you said.
So Reb Yosef Meir went out, and he took his horse and he went back and told the Talmidei Chachamim that the king would call the Galach and try to talk to him. And so the king sent out one of his knights, which is a very big servant to the king, to go call the Galach to come speak to him. The knight rode his big giant horse up the hill to the cloister, the big giant black cloister, which was surrounded by a cemetery. And he got off his horse and he walked to the front door and he knocked on the front door. And the door opened up and there was Igor, the Kishevmacher's helper.
What can I do for you?
Well, I'm Sir William, I'm the king's mishoris, and I was asked to come here and summon your boss, the Kishevmacher, to come speak to the king. The king wants to speak with him right away.
No problem, I'll give him the message.
And so the knight left, and Igor went down the steps, the winding steps, all the way down to the basement, to the room where the Galach was practicing his magic. And in the room, there were all kinds of magical kishiftige tumene zachen, and there was the Galach, the Russia, what he was. Igor, who was at the door?
It was a knight from the king, and he said the king wants you to come right away.
The king wants me to come right away.
Igor, we better hurry like an Uri. You know that an Uri is always in a hurry. If the king wants to see me right away.
We don't want to be late like an eight. And you know, Igor, an eight is usually very late. Go hitch up the horses in the wagon, and we'll head out immediately like an idiotly. You know, an idiotly does things always immediately. When you have the horses hitched up, tell me and I will come like an You know, an will always come.
So Igor went upstairs to the barn, and he hitched the horses in the wagon, and he called this Russia, this Galach upstairs, and the Galach came up in his cloak, that Russia what he was, and they started heading through the countryside. Till they came to the king's castle, the Galach called out to the servant on top of the tower, "Open like a bowpin! Open the drawbridge!" So I can get through like an ooh, and an ooh, you know, is always getting through. And the servant opened up the door immediately, shaking because he knew how powerful this Galach was. And the Galach said to him, "Take me as quickly as you could to the king like an ing, because an ing is always going to the king." And so the servant took him as quickly as he could to the waiting room. And he said, "Why don't you sit down over here and I'll go in and tell the king that you're here." And he went and he told the king that the Galach is there, came out and said to the Galach, "The king will see you right now." "Of course he'll see me now like an owl. An owl always sees me now." And he came walking into the king's throne room.
"I thank you very much for coming."
"Your Majesty." "Your Majesty, it is an honor to be here like a gear. And a gear is always here. What can I do for you like an ooh?"
"Well, the Yiddish community was here not long ago. They sent the president of your town to speak to me. They're very concerned. There's all kinds of problem and sorrows going on in the town, and they say that they think that is you."
"Me?" "Well, of course it's me. Who else would be making these problems if not for me?"
"Well, is there anything perhaps that you can do to stop doing these terrible things to them?"
"Your Majesty." "Your Majesty, I see that you are not well versed in the ways of magic." "You see, if someone is a professional sorcerer, keshifmacher, they always need to practice like an actus." "And you know, Your Majesty, an actus always is at practice." "Now, Your Majesty, who else would you want me to practice on, if not the Eden?"
"You wouldn't want me to practice on the king like an ing?"
"Would you?" "I don't think so, like an O."
No. I don't think that would be appropriate at all. No.
"I didn't think so. I think it makes sense to practice on the Eden. So therefore, I can't help it. I need to do it like an Uit. And an Uit is always going to do it." "What do you suggest, Your Majesty?"
"Well, I really don't know what to say."
"Ah, you don't know what to say like an A.
And an A always has to say, well, let me help you out and tell you what to say. I need the Jews to practice on them, so I'll make you a deal. You go back to the Jews and you tell them as follows. Tell them like this. I must practice, and as long as they're in the town, I will be practicing on them like an M, unless they leave the town. But, here's the catch. I will let them stay in the town like an Oun, cause an Oun, you know, can always stay in town with one condition, like an Ishin. And you know that Ishins always have at least one condition. And that is, I have tremendous powers of Tumah. If they can bring someone from anywhere in the world that has the Koyach and the power of Kedusha, that can battle against my power of Tumah and beat me, they can stay in the town and I will not bother them. Pass that message on to them and let me know if they agree. Because if they do agree, it's in a month from now that they must produce the man that will fight me like an Itmi, and an Itmi is always ready to fight me. So long, Your Majesty.
And Kindalach this Russia walked out of the throne room.